Yahusha, there's always time for everyone to die. Always. But the son of Yahuwah would die in divine timing. But for those who don't believe in the Most High, there's always time for all of us to die who don't believe. Anytime. And see how direct he spoke to them, but gracefully. And they still didn't understand or comprehend. It's so interesting. That's condescending in truth right there. Hallelujah. It is impossible for the world to hate you, but it hates me because I bear witness of it. That means he judges the world based off of their actions and how they live and carry themselves. Not everyone is bad and not everyone is good. You go up to this festival. It is possible for the world to hate you, but it hates me because I bear witness of it, that its works are wicked. You go up to this festival. I am not yet going up to this festival, for my time has not yet been fulfilled. And having said this to them, he said and stayed in Galilee. But when his brothers had gone up to the festival, then he also went up, not openly, but as it were in secret. The Yahudim therefore were seeking him at the festival and said, "Where is he?" Exactly, where is she? Where is he? Where are them? Where are they? Where's mom? Where's dad? Where is she? Where is him? Where are they? And there was much grumbling about him among the crowd. Of course, gossiping, grumbling, gossiping, of course. So much grumbling and gossiping. Talking amongst the groups of people, hee hee and ha ha, talking. Oh, they talk, talk, talk. They love to talk about absolutely nothing. We're saying he is good, but others were saying no, but he is leading the crowd astray. However, no one spoke openly of him for fear of the Yahudim. And about the middle of the festival, Yahusha went up into the Mikdash and he was teaching. And the Yahudim were marveling, saying, "How does this man know letters, not having learned?" Yahusha answered them and said, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me." See, when people come along and have this highlighted wisdom, other people want to point the finger and say, "It's you, you, you," but they don't understand that there's a divine power above us all, directing like a orchestra conductor, certain individuals, the violin players, the flute players, the trombone players, the drummers, the bass player, etc. And those who are humbled will never take credit for the things that they do, but will give all the gratitude and humbled thankfulness to the Most High, because we do not make ourselves, nor do we create our own words. Hallelujah. If anyone desires to do his desire, but our entire society is based off of, "Look at me, look at me, look at me, look at what I do, look at who I am, look at what I got, look at my car, look at my money, look at my," I was going to say the H-O-E-S words, look at this, look at that, look at me, I'm so this, I'm so, and when you're absolutely nothing, you're nothing. You're not responsible for anything, you didn't make yourself. The one who made you can take us out at any time. You didn't make your car, you didn't make your clothes, you didn't make you. He gave you an option to create children. Some of you have created children, and children are a beautiful blessing. And a good parent is a rare gift on the earth these days. Blessings to you for that. But we should not be taking credit for anything, but a lot of people in the industry or on television have the whole personification of, "Look at me, look at me, look at me." And I always say, what am I looking at? When you don't give thanks to who created you, but you decided to give thanks to something that can control you instead. And the Most High made that element that controls you as well. "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If anyone desires to do his desire, he shall know concerning the teaching whether it is from Elohim or I speak from myself. He who speaks from himself is seeking his own esteem." Exactly. Exactly. "But he who seeks the esteem of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness in him. Did not Moshe give you the Torah? Yet not one of you does the Torah. Why do you seek to kill me? The crowd answered and said, you have a demon who seeks to kill you. Yahusha answered, yet our whole society right now, everybody who watches TV, things like that, all these people, those tennis shoes this person has made who's full of demons and got demonic blood in the bottom of them and all that, just the society is obsessed with watching people who are demonically possessed. It's crazy. It's crazy. Yahusha answered and said to them, I did one work and you all marvel. Because of this, Moshe has given you the circumcision, though it is not from Moshe, but from the fathers. And you circumcise a man on the Shabbat. If a man receives circumcision on the Shabbat so that the Torah of Moshe should not be broken, are you wroth with me because I made a man entirely well on the Shabbat? That means these people are doing heinous acts on the Shabbat when we should all be resting, but then they get mad at him for actually healing somebody on the Shabbat. Interesting. He'd rather have them be sick and suffer when they could be healed. Interesting. Very interesting. Do not judge according to the appearance. Exactly. Because when you judge to the appearance, you're living in your flesh and you're drawing from your ego, your insecurities, etc. Your perception, which could be tainted, or you could be demonically possessed and you have no perception. Interesting. Do not judge according to the appearance, but judge with righteous judgment, divine judgment, therefore in the spirit. Therefore, some of them from Yerushalayim said, is this not he whom they are seeking to kill? Oh, I know that. And see, he speaks boldly like a lion. And they say none at all to him. They don't say anything to him, but they gossip and cackle and hee hee har har, hee 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 hee, and ha 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 ha, all of that. In the background, like a shadow. And see, he speaks boldly and they say none at all to him. Could it be that the rulers truly know that this is truly HaMashiach? But we know where this one is from. And when HaMashiach comes, no one knows where he is from. Interesting. Yahusha therefore cried out in the Mikdash, teaching and saying, you both know me, and you know where I am from, and I have not come of myself, but he who sent me is true, whom you do not know. But I know him, because I am from him, and he sent me. So you believe, audience, that some people get angelically sent into your life to heal you and take care of you and make sure you get on the right path, you get to your higher self, because there may be things later on down the line in your life that you need to do certain types of works for other people and other children and other lands and under other countries and etc. But if you're concerned with the moment now and concerned with what's going on in the flesh, you just might miss it, and you just might never get another opportunity for another angel to be sent down on earth to take you where you need to go. And then it's that Erykah Badu song, next lifetime. But what if this is the last book of Revelations? Like, what if this is truly, we're truly at the end, where all our ancestors, beloved or not, waited for? Abraham hasn't even seen this. Isaac hasn't even seen this. Yeshayahu hasn't even seen this. What if this is truly the end of Revelations? Then there would be no more lifetime. There would just be a new heaven and then the furnace of fire, which people like to say the lake of fire. But the lake of fire is the volcano exploding. The true words, as everything has been truly manipulated, is the furnace of fire. It is a furnace of fire. The lake of fire is repetitiously associated with a volcano, because when a volcano spews its fire, it creates a lake of fire that exists on earth. But the true fire is called the furnace of fire, which preludes into hell. There's levels to this. but I can't say everything because people are too busy trying to be me and copy and live in an illusion instead of in reality. And that's why I've developed other places for us to meet, which I'll make an announcement about, and there'll be free clothes and things like that for the first couple of subs. Hallelujah, let's keep it moving. But I know him because I am from him, and he sent me. So they were seeking to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him because his hour had not yet come. And many of the crowd believed in him and said, when HaMashiach comes, shall he do more signs than these, which this one did? And the Pharisees heard the crowd muttering and cha-cha-cha, these concerning him, and sent officers to seize him. Therefore, Yahusha said to them, yet a little while I am with you. Then I go to whom him who sent me. You shall seek me, and you shall not find me. And where I am, you are unable to come. Wow. You shall seek me, and you shall not find me. That's like anybody in a relationship. It's not going well. Friendship, works, situation, family, situation. You can apply all of this to your situation. And you're tired of it. And you know you're out of there. You got to keep it moving. You shall seek me, and you shall not find me. Because when people... when you change, you have to be the change. You want change, you have to change. So when you change, then it's too late when people come back looking for you because you're not there. And where you're going, because they haven't done the work, they won't be able to come. Perfect sense. Perfect sense. The Yehudim therefore said to themselves, where is he about to go that we shall not find him? Is he about to go to the dispersion among the Yahwanites? Yahwanites is an ancient word for Greeks. And to teach the Yahwanites, what is this word which he said, you shall seek me, and you shall not find me, and where I am, you are unable to come. And on the last great day of the festival, Yahusha stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me, and let him who believes in me drink. As the scripture said, out of his innermost shall flow rivers of living water. And this he said concerning the Ruah, which those believing in him were about to receive. For the Ruah HaKodesh means the Spirit. But in religious cultures, they've taken this word and broken it down and call it the Holy Spirit, or and other things that they call it. But it's the Ruah HaKodesh. That's the true word, the truth, not a substitute teacher of the truth. But the truth, the Ruach HaKodesh. You know how the teacher's not coming in that day, so they send a substitute. Right. A copy. Not the real deal. Was not yet, because Yahusha was not yet esteemed. Many from the crowd, when they heard the word, then said, this is truly the Nabi. Nabi means priest in Paleo Hebrew. Others said, this is HaMashiach. But others said, does HaMashiach then come out of Galil? Did not the scripture say that HaMashiach comes from the seed of Dawid, King Dawid, one of the first kings, one of the first many kings, but one of the most popular kings to be chosen by the Most High, that killed Goliath, the big giant, and cut his head off with a pebble and a rubber band for King Saul. Hallelujah. He was a good man. And he was human. We all have our faults. But he was a good man. He lived for the Most High. Period. And from the village of Bethlehem, where Dawid was. So a division came about the people because of him. And some of them wanted to take him, but no one laid their hands on him. The officers therefore came to the chief Kohanim and Pharisees, and they said to them, why did you not bring him? See, this is when Yahusha is getting set up to be betrayed. The officers answered, never has any man spoken like this man. I'm sure they say that about me. The Pharisees therefore answered them, have you also been led astray? Has any one of the rulers or of the Pharisees believed in him?